Good morning, good morning, good morning, and what a spectacular morning it is. Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. The night has been dark and cloudy and windy, and we're waking up to see what's been happening throughout the bush in the middle of the night. Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie. I have Tebs on camera with me this morning. Brent is out with Andrew, following up on the tracks of Karula to see if he can relocate her after yesterday's sunset safari. Big welcome to Joe Wood and any other new viewers. We are coming to you live from the Juma and Arethusa game reserves within the Sabi Sands, and that all falls under the Greater Kruger National Park within South Africa, an enormous wilderness area that has been under protection and the animals have moved about for the last 100 or so years. And as you can see, it is a stunning morning, absolutely beautiful. Let's just sit and listen for a moment to the joy of the birds waking up. Crested franklins, scrub robins, drongos, a red-chested cuckoo all calling and greeting the new morning. I'm on my way across to the eastern boundary to see if those lions from last night have made an appearance. In the meantime, let's pop over to Brent so that he can say good morning as well.
So, welcome to Safari Live. We're back in the area where Karula was last. Oh, I see eyes on that termite mound. I wonder what it could be. I think it's a little bush baby. I don't think I know it's a little bush baby now. Moving up that little knob thorn, hopefully it's still there by the time we get there. By the way, I'm Brent Leo Smith. I've got Andrew Joseph Francis on camera, and this is Safari Live, and we're in search of a female leopard. But the magnificent thing about the bush is while we search for everything, we find others. And here we go, look at that. Tiny little bush baby, or South African Galago, on his way home. Oh, disappeared behind the tree. I'm just gonna go back a little bit. Might be a hole that it's disappeared into, where it's going to spend. Now, do you see anything, Andrew? Maybe try forward. Hoping it might pop, skip and jump. But let's have a look. It could be another, it could be a hole. And it's at its roosting site for the night. There isn't a hole, but it's definitely done, or she's done, a disappearing act on us. I'm just going to check up the tree. See if we can go even higher. And they got they can jump incredible distances, but it's made a disappearing act. But what a wonderful way to start the Sunrise Safari. So, bush baby families have little territories that they patrol and defend quite extensively against other little bush babies. So they will have multiple nest sites sort of in their territory. And depending on where they end up for the evening while out foraging, they'll go back to that. So one of the fascinating ways about how they mark their territory, and it's got a double-edged benefit to them, is that they urinate on their hands. And so the two reasons for this. The one is that they have nice sticky hands if you are jumping from branch to branch, and it gives a little bit more grip. But also it enables them to spread their scent over a much further distance, not only where they urinate, but everywhere they climb, their scent will be. So really, really fascinating little creatures. And quite ferocious little predators if you're a moth or other nocturnal flying insect. So they do feed quite extensively on that, also on fruits and also on gum, specifically acacia gum and also ebony gum. And what they'll do is they'll actually almost farm the gum, so they'll chew on certain trees at the exact spot, forcing the tree to exude gum. I will have a look and see if I can find you some gum later on Sunrise Safari. thankfully, the Queen of Juma, Karula, is still in the area. It was a very small kill. She might have finished it overnight. And then we may have to start tracking all over again. But that's half the fun, isn't it? Ominous, cloudy morning to Rich Levy in Highland Park. And Rich wondering, guys who work in a sort of traditional safari lodges, what is their average sort of work leave cycle? How long do they work before they go and leave? They work on a very similar cycle to what we do, Rich. It's generally 6 weeks on and 2 weeks off. So you'll be on for 7 days a week for the 6 weeks in some form or another, but then 2 weeks off every 6 weeks. And of course this is quite wonderful for us. If you think about it, we get nice big chunks of holiday. And the problem is when you go visit people, everyone else has the 9 to 5, so while you are loafing during your 2 week break on a sort of Monday at 10 o'clock, there's not many of your friends who can join you for a cup of coffee. Okay, we're right in this area where Karula was last seen. Maybe we'll also find Scott's Canadian. Who knows? A beautiful morning, I agree. And she says, what happened with Karula and her Dereka on last night's sunset safari? We're right in the spot, and I know just before Scott left she did start feeding on it, and it was right there in this, at the base of this little thicket, and it looks to be gone. So there's one of two options to what Karula's done. If she was quite full, she might have stashed it in a tree around, which we'll go have a look at now. The other option is she might have just scoffed it all down and finished it. We should have a quick look. This is the tree that Scott and Vim had that chameleon in on the sunset safari. I'm just making sure we can't find it, see if it's just moved along. And I keep forgetting. Let's have a look. Quite often, chameleons are on the peripheries of bushes like this in the early morning and during the night, but they are mobile. So it looks like it has moved on. So a couple of safaris ago, Raisa asked me if I'd seen 3-horned chameleons, and I promised to show a picture of the largest chameleon species in the world, and that occurs in the Miombo woodlands, northern Mozambique, southern Tanzania, northern Zambia. So I went into my archives onto my computer and managed to pull that picture off to show you guys, and it is an incredible thing. As I said, it's about the size of a Jack Russell. So I've only seen them 3 times in southern Tanzania. There we go. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? That is the largest chameleon species on Earth. Believe it or not, they actually eat birds. Well, it big congratulations to Kat in Tampa, Florida. We've never seen a bush baby before, so very excited. Ticking it off her. What are you doing? And Andrew is basically complaining that I'm driving while I'm reversing. I'm putting him in a push. And I just have one thing to say. Andrew, be thankful it wasn't a thorn tree. The next one might be if you continue this behavior on drive. So, well done to Kat for getting her first bush baby and adding it to her Safari Live mammal list. So we're just going to check. There's a marula. She hasn't popped it in one of these marula trees. All of them look quite nice for hoisting. To answer Jared, he's wondering, is that the South African lesser bush baby? Yes, that is the old name for that bush baby species. It was a lesser bush baby. It is now named a South African Galego. So no diker in the tree. I'm almost hoping as I look a little bit further afield to sort of see that very distinct feline outline in the sky, but I think she's scoffed it all. We're just going to check this last marula tree. If nothing there, we're going to hop on board with Jamie and she can give you an update down on the eastern boundary. So nothing in the tree. Let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Across onto Cheetah Cutline, and I'm checking really carefully to see if the lions have decided to make their way back onto Juma. Now, I hear that you were with a bush baby with Brent, and I have to just tell you the story that we had before we went live. Tebs and I were out driving in the dark and we stopped to look at a bush baby, and it launched itself across over the bonnet, but it misjudged and it very nearly landed on the car. And we seem to be developing a bit of a theme at the moment. Animals appearing to want to join us on our safaris, which I'm sure you can all understand. And we did have a viewer who's fairly new to our safaris, as far as I know, and I have a question to ask you. You wanted to know if the safari guides like your name. Well, actually, we were just tossing up, is it safari, like safari, but you're a South African? Is that what we're going with? Just let us know. I do like your name, by the way, if that's where it's going. I enjoy that. A safa, for those of you who are unfamiliar, is a South African. It's the term for a South African. I'm not sure if it's something that South Africans came up with and has just been adopted, or if it came from somewhere else. I mean, there's South Africans spread out throughout the globe. So safari or safari, let us know if we're getting your name right, which way you want us to pronounce it. Might make answering any questions or comments that you might have a little bit easier. And don't forget, for new viewers watching either on or on any of the various platforms, you can send us through questions and comments, anything that you'd like to chat about or ask about. We're really keen to hear from you, so please do. There's nothing better than being able to interact with you on a more personal level. A quick summary of our evening last night. We had the three Nkuhumas. They killed a buffalo on the sunrise safari. It was a smallish buffalo, sub-adult, year-old size. They were finished fairly quickly because there was one Birmingham boy who happened to be in attendance. He, I think, scoffed most of that. We stayed with them at Bibbleshook Dam for the entire afternoon. Right at the end, they started to hunt waterbuck. Now, I'm not sure what went wrong in that hunt. I couldn't switch on my engine and I couldn't shine my lights, so I couldn't really see, but something, they obviously missed the hunt and the waterbuck got away and moved off. They wandered across towards water. Now, I think that they went to Bibbleshook Dam because they thought there was going to be water there. It's been so long since the Nkuhumas wandered around that particular area that they obviously hadn't realized how much the dam had dried up. We also had the most amazing sighting of an elephant bull trying to go into Bibbleshook Dam itself to get at the plants that were growing around. Oh, guy in the plant sector spoke this morning to Brent about it, and the name's just gone straight out of my head, the plants that are growing on the mud at Buffer's Hook. They are apparently quite toxic, at least to certain animals, but apparently the elephants absolutely love them. South African living in Saudi Arabia, and you said that, yep, we are migratory, but we always return home. There's a saying that I was first taught when I came to work in the bush, and that if your feet touch soil, you either come back to visit regularly or you just never leave. You can understand why. And while I double check around the tracks, Brent has found one of the waterbuck that I was chatting about a little bit earlier, so let's pop over and have a look.
So we're with some waterbuck that whose brethren nearly became the evening meal for the Nkuhuma Pride last night, and you can see wonderfully fluffy in the neck. You have very elegant look about them. And you know, some young males here as well, sitting and watching us. And you can see that very distinct, even from this distance, white ring around the bottom, a following mechanism for follow each other through thick bush. I've probably been ruminating for the majority of the night, now up and at them, so to speak, in the early morning. I start moving off to feed. The emblem of the Sabi Sands Game Reserve is a big male waterbuck with wonderful wide sweeping horns. So Judy was saying, Brent, why do you call Andrew Joseph Francis when we know his middle name is Anand? Well, I'm going to let Andrew answer that. Andrew, why do I call you Andrew Joseph Francis?
That's my birth middle name, so.
Here we go. So Anand is a nickname?
Yes.
And his proper middle name is Joseph. I think maybe we should start just calling him Joseph for a while, see how he takes to that.
That's fine by me.
Here we go. So we're going to leave these waterbuck. So what we're doing at the moment is we are circling the area where Karula is last seen. And we're going to check all the roads around to see if we find any of those pretty little petite cat tracks coming out of the area. Lovely pink hue starting to form on the horizon up here. Oh, hello. Zebras. And a lot of our long-time viewers will have noticed very much an increase in zebra sightings. Now, the reason for this is twofold. One is because of the very dry conditions that we're experiencing at the moment. So the water in this area is drawing the zebras in from far afield. And the reason they are coming from far afield is that in the last sort of year and a half, the Kruger National Park has changed its one of its policies. And very interesting, and I am all for it. And the reason is that they've closed all the majority of the man-made water holes around the park, keeping very few of them open. 60s and 70s, when those water holes were created, the long-term implications of that were not really understood. So what happened is all these water holes were put into parts of the park where there was never permanent water. And what this caused was a sort of migration of game and also a complete change in habits. And in doing so, they inadvertently almost has completely wiped out certain species in the park, and the main ones being roan sable and brown hyena. So traditionally or historically what happened is there would be pans and around, and during the rainy season animals like wildebeest, zebra, buffalo, to a lesser extent spotted in a hyena and lions, following those animals, would move into these areas where there were only pans, and for the wet season they would all focus around there. As soon as the dry season came, those animals that are very dependent on water, so zebra, wildebeest, buffalo in particular, would then move back down to the permanent water seeps and rivers. And for an animal like sable and roan that are very, very specialist feeders, it was very, very important, so they wouldn't have to compete during the dry season with those bulk grazers. But now, with the water being permanent, those animals never left. So it basically, they got out-competed. And the same with the brown hyena. The brown hyena can never compete with the spotted hyena. And the spotted hyena is very far more dependent on water than brown hyena. So now that there was permanent water in these areas, the spotted hyena stayed and basically caused a local extinction of the brown hyena. So after sort of 50, 60 years, the Kruger has, and this is incredible, that they are actually big enough to admit when they're wrong, and they've now closed these water holes. Another really important aspect of this is that when you have the animals traveling quite often big distances between water and seasonally using different environments, it's very good for something that we like to refer to as hoof action. And that's why I know a lot of people can probably be quite upset with me, but I'm quite excited for this drought. So we've had a very wet cycle, and a lot of this thickness of the bush, it shouldn't be this thick. If we look at a lot of these trees, they're sort of 10 to 12 years old, so all grown during this wet cycle. So traditionally, if we look historically sort of back beyond the 60s from old aerial photographs, this whole area was far more open and far more grassland. And I'm going to definitely take you to an area where it's very visible what the elephants are doing at the moment. So there's no grass for the elephants to eat, which they normally eat at this time of the year, and they're now absolutely annihilating these younger bush willows and terminalias. And what that is it's actually going to open up the bush more, and it's creates more space for grass. A lot of grass doesn't like to grow under trees, and quite often you're really good grazing grasses. So even though we might have a drop off in herbivore numbers now during the drought, while the weak ones are unable to survive and they're picked off by the predators, when the next sort of good wet season comes, the grass will make a comeback. And also with the amount of sort of hoof action I was talking about, animals moving to and from and digging up the soil, you can imagine if you're a gardener and you take a garden fork and you till the soil to turn over that nice rich topsoil and plant seeds. So that's naturally happening, and especially those big herds of buffalo, very important for that, and especially during a dry period, they're often moving very big distances. They turn up the soil and they also fertilize as they go. So very, very interesting, and it's going to create a much more open environment, which is better for the wildebeest, zebra and buffalo. So it's very interesting how nature works, and you have this sort of wet cycle when the trees dominate for a while, and now we're going through to a dry cycle, and hopefully the grass species will come back, and that will also be beneficial to the herbivores, as I was saying. And after the drought is over and the rain comes, their numbers should start increasing. So everything works in a balance, to quote my dad, quite often us as human beings consider ourselves above the natural system, and we start playing and getting involved in interfering. And it's a very apt description that my dad uses. He says, we're gardeners in Eden. We take something that works and it's perfect and we try to change it. And normally when we do that, we end up making huge mistakes, as quite apparent with what happened with the Kruger. So just in case you remember, we're gardeners in Eden. So we arrive in Eden, which is this perfect utopia that works and nature functions in balance, and then we go start adding water holes and we start doing this and that, so we end up changing the complete nature of the environment we live in. Oh, look at that, Andrew. And go. Isn't that spectacular? Here comes the rising sun popping over the eastern horizon. So another two or three ridges from there is actually boundary of the Kruger National Park. Very good morning, and hopefully you've got your long stockings on and your fireplace roaring. Anna-Marie. Anna-Marie says, isn't it incredible and amazing? She can't believe that sometimes she's sitting at home in a major blizzard and watching a stunning African sunrise here with us on Safari Live. Always good while we enjoy the sunrise, just listen for a few seconds, see if we hear any notable sounds. And what we're listening for is obviously possibly the call of a big cat. Oh, Andrew spotted a hole, disused aardvark hole, and it's not a home hole. That looks like a hole that has been excavated to try and get at some termites. So the dawn chorus is starting. You can hear a lot of sort of off to the left of us, and those are long-tailed shrikes or magpie shrikes waking up. And I can hear some hardy-dars flying over. Not the most beautiful call in the African bush. John in England says, we know Vim is the wildebeest, but possibly Andrew should earn his nickname, which is the aardvark, and find us an aardvark. I agree with you 100%, John. Andrew, find us an aardvark. There is a possibility at this time of the morning that they might still be up. Unfortunately, the active den site I did know about is no longer active, and they do change den sites. And I am very much hoping to be the first presenter to be able to show everyone an aardvark on the live drives. So fingers crossed. And I'm definitely going to have to keep looking for active aardvark dens. So we're going to carry on. We're checking, for those of you who might have got up a little bit late or joined us a little bit late, Karula was in this area behind me, and we're checking around it to see where she's come out and where she might possibly have been. Fortunately, lots of elephant around, so the tracks might be quite difficult to spot, but that's half the fun. We're on the hunt for Karula, and while we continue, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Speaking of animals wandering across tracks, I wanted to show you the tracks of where the Nkuhumas crossed last night. Unfortunately, a group of Dugga boys, or buffalo males, walked straight across them and pretty much obliterated them. But I really want to focus on showing you guys some of the tracks from last night. I'm just waiting for the sun to get up a little bit, trying to time it so that the light is perfect for having a look. And for those of you who were watching last night as the Nkuhumas walked up the road, it will be a really nice opportunity for you all to get an idea of what it looks like when, or what the tracks look like exactly at that, the speed that they were walking at. This is where the buffalo kill was, around this particular block. Seems to be quiet though this morning. I know that big herd of buffalo walked through yesterday. It doesn't look as though they've made their way back here. No sign of the Nkuhumas crossing back onto Juba, but that doesn't mean that they're not going to. It's still nice and cool. It's actually quite chilly this morning. Currently we started off the morning at about 20 degrees or 71 degrees Fahrenheit, which maybe for those of you in colder climates, you must be thinking it's absolutely ridiculous that we call that cold. But I think we lose a little bit of perspective here as to what cold actually is, and this morning feels a bit chilly. I wonder, it's good news, though, for the cats. It means that they're going to be wandering around. Hello, Vulture. He's on his way. It was that hooded vulture from yesterday afternoon. Yesterday afternoon, Andrew and I were tracking the lionesses, and we came round the corner and a vulture got startled and shot out of the tree on the right of us. And as a result, both of us were so busy looking at it, we completely missed the lions that were underneath the tree for a good 5 or so seconds before we realized they were there. I think we were just out of practice in terms of lion spotting. But the vultures hanging on, there's not much left of the buffalo. And having a look now at the road, the hyenas have cruised through at some point last night as well. The little hoodeds, they can pick at the little bones and pieces that are left. As we're driving along Biffle's Hook East, Christopher, you were wondering whether or not all of the roads on Juma and Arethusa have names and if there are any maps available. Well, Christopher, a big warm welcome. Christopher's watching all the way in Arizona. Yes, all of the roads have names because it makes it so much easier for guides to call in sightings, describe where something is. You can imagine if within our road network we had to say that one road that runs east of Biffle's Hook Dam. Okay, maybe that was a bad example because the road is called Biffle's Hook East, but you get my drift. And what you'll find is actually really fascinating is the stories behind why roads are called what they're called. It's one of my favorite things to do at every reserve that I've worked at is to try and get a bit of the story behind why they have that name. And the one, there's some beautiful road names. There's one that's on the reserve I used to work at called Hlalagahle, which means go well. It's a traditional, it's a South African farewell. And you say it to somebody who's leaving to go away from you. If a person is staying and you want to say goodbye, you say Salagahle, which means stay well. And this particular road, sorry, I'm just checking this dam to see if anybody's come down. But the story behind that was actually there was a memorial to some of the reserve owners that had died in a plane crash. But beautiful stories behind road names. All kinds of stories. Oh, that's what I wanted to do. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to wander down into Biffle's Hook Dam. I wonder if Rusty's signal will be up for it. I wanted to go explore the mud where the elephant walked last night. Let's go do that while we wait for the sun to come up and I can show you those lion tracks. Let's see if we can manage. Watching from Canada. I'm glad that you're sticking with us and watching the sunrise. And you were wondering if all of the animals have names. Sorry, just got to negotiate a bumpy patch. And Joe, generally our leopards and our lions absolutely do. That's pretty much a reserve tradition within South Africa. So our leopards and our lions are named. Recently we've been trying to give names to the hyenas to try and keep track of them. But beyond that, we don't tend to name any of the other animals. Sometimes there might be a particular character that is really interesting. So for example, an elephant or a hippo that's made itself at home around us that we see regularly, and then we might name them. But for the most part, it's largely the leopards and the lions that get names. This is where the elephant was walking yesterday. You can see there is actually a bit of water, and if we look, Tebs, if we can zoom in on the mud around that water, I see tracks in there. And those look like lion tracks. So maybe the Nkumas were more sensible than we realized. Difficult to see. I'm going to hop up and have a closer look. Let's have a look and see. Looks like lion tracks to me. Oh, oh my word. This could end badly. I could end up in the mud. Yep. These lions definitely came down to drink yesterday. It must have happened sometime before we saw them. But you can see how they've splayed into the mud and their toes have spread out as they've led down to have a drink. And this is the only real spot where they could actually come down and have water. And I don't know how clearly you can see it, but there's 1, 2, 3, 4 toes and the back pad sliding in ever so slightly into the mud. Well, that's awesome to see. So they were sensible, they did have a drink. Now yesterday, when we were here watching the Nkuhumas, I was telling you about that big elephant bull that walked into the mud. Now, I can't position the car to go and see exactly how deep it is where he was walking, but I'm going to take a little walk, a little stroll, and you can have a look to see exactly how deep it actually is. See if I can show you without disappearing into the mud myself. Now, apparently, Brent was able to walk across this mud. Let's see if it works for me. Sure. Really, really deep. And then he was stretching out. This one's even deeper. Oh. I'm not going in there. Oh, look at this. So for those of you who were watching yesterday, I said that I wanted to come back and just see. That hole that I was in there came up to about mid-thigh, but he was actually much, much deeper. There's another one further in. That probably would end up about to my waist height. So I'm about 5'7", so that puts it at about 3 feet down, maybe about 4 feet down into the mud. It was extraordinary to witness. I didn't go into the deepest hole because I was a little bit concerned I may never come out again. Cool. Nice to just have a look at those sorts of things. It was fascinating to see. I was so surprised by his commitment to the cause. Moment. So just to finish up with that particular elephant sighting, that bull that we were looking at had fairly average, wow, that sun is incredible, that sky, sorry, distraction, short attention span, but that really is truly beautiful. I know that you were looking at it with Brent, but it's the first time I've had a proper look. Wow. Beautiful. Right, back to the elephant. Concentrate, Jamie. Stop getting distracted by the pretty sky. Back to the question about that elephant. Oh, thank you for the reminder. Nikki's just really kindly reminded me to avoid the landmines that the lions dropped on this road. Thank you, Nikki. We'll be very careful where we drive. I'm talking about lion scat, and you really, 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 really don't want to drive through it. It's the smell will stick on your wheels for ages afterwards, unless you do something drastic, like drive through sand or something to clear it. And it actually, the animals that you stop to watch afterwards have a tendency to then sprint away from you because you carry the lion's scent. And not only that, it's actually quite miserable for the people concerned on the back. Yesterday, Andrew and myself were struggling a little bit with the smell. It was making my eyes burn. But yes, the elephant bull that wandered into the dam yesterday was a fairly average-sized elephant bull. Not the biggest tusks I've ever seen. But Monkey Man, you were wondering how big can an elephant's tusks actually get to? Now, there's an incredible museum in the Kruger National Park, which is an area open to us, that has some of the biggest tuskers ever recorded within the Kruger National Park. And those tusks are taller than me, taller than Brent even. Brent's about 2 meters, so about 6 roughly. A little bit shorter, just a fraction. Okay, quite a big fraction. But yes, those tusks can get to absolutely enormous lengths. I'm talking over 2 meters. And in terms of weight, some of the heaviest that were recorded there, one of them went right up to 80 kilograms, one tusk, 80 kilograms. That's about 160 pounds. Imagine walking around with that weight on the edge of your face, on the end of your face. You can imagine a lever, the length of them. Astronomical to think about. Now, let me find you a nice set of lion tracks, because safari, you want to know what the average size of the lion paw is. Oh, and I've just realized why I'm smelling Buffalo's Hook Dam. I've taken some of it back with me on my knee. Oh dear. That is unintentional. It's quite smelly, bud. And now I have a smelly knee. Oh well, I suppose it's better than lion scat. Wonderful stuff. So Caitlin, who is 11, oh sorry, let me just try and get a nice position on these lion tracks, because I really want to answer this question properly. Tebs, do you think if we have a look at those, we'll be able to see them in this light? So both Safari, who is watching our show, and Caitlin and Kayla, who are 11 and 10 respectively, apparently those two little ladies watch our show regularly. They watch our Sunset Safari as part of their homeschool education, and they watch our Sunrise Safari at night, but sometimes get tired. So yesterday we were looking at the bottom of the lion's pad, and I said that big cats have 3 lobes at the back and dogs and hyenas have 2. Caitlin and Kayla have gone checking up because they wanted to have a look at their dog and their cat's feet, and they noticed that at the back of their dog's pad, their dog has also got 3 lobes. So you were wondering whether or not it's a general division, or if all canines have only 2 pads at the back. Let me hop out. I want to show you what I mean. We still need the sun to come up a bit, actually, to see this track clearly, but it helped the average size as well. So first, let's deal with the size. This is the track that we're looking at here. Oh, I'm going to give you a bit of perspective. This is the size of my hand. And it's about the size of this lioness's front track. So the front feet of all animals are always, with some exceptions, which I'll get to in a moment, but almost all animals, they carry most of their body weight on the front. So the majority of their body weight sits around their shoulders and their head, means that their front tracks are nice and big and round, whereas their back tracks are slightly smaller and more narrow. If I grab a stick, I can actually trace for you what I mean about the back pads. Now it's not the clearest light, but at the back, the track goes 1, 2, 3, and then there's 1, 2, 3, 4 toes. This is the front track here, shaped in a nice circle, and the back track, which is a bit more pointy. So for Caitlin and for Kayla, with your question about whether all dogs and hyenas have 3 lobes or 2 lobes, they still have the sort of the third lobe, but it's a bit smaller in dogs, which means it doesn't show up clearly when they leave footprints. So for your research, have a look where your dog walks. Maybe if your dog walks in mud or on some sand, have a look and see if you can see that third lobe. Usually you can't. And I've looked on my dog's track as well, and I can see that I can only see the 2 lobes, even though there are 3 at the back. Whereas with cats, those 3 lobes show up nice and clearly. And it's especially clear with the big cats because their feet are nice and big. This is from last night with the lionesses walking down the road. I'm still going to try and find you a clearer one. Come on, son. You need to come up so we can see the tracks properly. But Caitlin and Kayla, I am very proud of you guys for going and doing that research. I think that's a very good idea. And for all kids watching, the tracks that you learn about here, you can do the same thing at home. Have a look at the animal tracks, have a look at horse tracks, deer tracks, anything like that. You can learn all about tracking in your hometown. Declan is 11 years old. Declan, you were wondering if there will be diseases in the mud on my leg. Declan, I hope not. No, I'll be absolutely fine. The smell is coming from some algae and some decomposing plant material, but nothing serious. Even though there have been a couple of rotting fish in Forsook Dam, those have mostly decomposed now. I'm not too worried, Declan, about it. I'm sure I will be absolutely fine. Luckily though, it's on my knee and not in my mouth or in an open cut. Generally quite a good idea to keep those quite clean. Well, while I continue on my search for nice tracks to show you and interesting things to teach you, let's pop over to Brent for an update.
So we did manage to find Karula's tracks, but we've left them. Orby just came over the radio saying there was a male leopard calling in this area. So we've come to give him a hand here. And if we don't have any luck with this male leopard, we'll go back onto Karula's last tracks. Her tracks were actually heading in this direction. The last track was about 1.5 kilometers to the west of us. And we have a new viewer called The Awesome One on YouTube who says, that looks like a cool job. It is a very cool job, and we're very lucky to have a job that we love. And The Awesome One, don't forget, you can also ask us questions about our awesome job. And you can do that by popping us an email at questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So we've left the female leopard tracks. We're on search of a big male leopard tracks. If I had to hesitate a guess, it's more than likely going to be Tingana. But who knows, could it be a new male? You never know. That's the best thing about the bush, is something completely strange and different could happen around every corner. So, I know Jamie's been showing you some tracks, and Roy and Patrick are wondering, can you tell the difference between male and female lion tracks? You can. You can actually also extend that into leopard. It's generally from the size. Put it this way, a big male lion track is like a small side plate, the size of my hand. There's a female probably be not half the size, but definitely substantially, yeah, probably about the same size as Jamie's hand. And the same can be said with female and male leopard tracks. A really big male leopard will almost be the same size as the palm of my hand and the female. And it depends. Certain animals have bigger tracks than others. And we know, so Karula, one of the female leopards we see regularly, has very small tracks. So guys, Jamie is just trying to get hold of me on the radio, so let's see what she wants. Go ahead. Welcome to move into the area. Aubrey's checking around Weave's Nest. He said the audio sounded somewhere sort of between Philemon's and the treehouse. I'm checking Shabam through to Gary Mann, then I'm going to do treehouse back down to Weaver's Nest. If we get no luck here, there are tracks at Karula that head sort of southeast from Ballinati's junction with Zoe's and Rebecca's. Saw me doing that is chatting to Jamie, who's out in a different part of the reserve. Also, sometimes I'll be chatting to Aubrey or Taxon or the other guides. And finding animals is a team game, so obviously, if there's more of you looking for an animal, it's easier to find. So, Aubrey and I are both looking for this male leopard who was calling. And for those of you who might not know what a male leopard sounds like when it calls, it's the best description I can give you. It's like sawing wood, and I suppose one step better than the description is an impersonation. So here goes my best male leopard call. It's often called coughing or sawing as well, but it's quite harsh on the throat. There we go, my best male leopard impersonation. Hopefully it doesn't get the male leopard we're looking for to cause any jealousy. You know, I might have a better grasp than he does. Andrew thought that was quite funny, by the way. So he's giggling behind me. Andrew and I are on the vehicle that is nicknamed, or its name is the Jiga, and that's J-I-G-G-A, and it's because it's a short wheel-based Land Rover is how it's got its name, and it can Jiga Jiga, which means it can twist and turn through the bush. That's how Jiga got its name, Jiga Jiga. And Laureen is wondering, why am I driving this vehicle today and Jamie's driving Rusty, and which determines which presenter drives which vehicle on which day, and are there any particular favorites? Well, with the vehicles, we rotate through them, so we'll do two drives on each vehicle before swapping, so it's very fair. We share the vehicles evenly, and Wendy got her name because it came as a name. Apparently it was called Wendy beforehand. And before we bought it, Wendy is a doctor. So she is in the town of Hoedspruit, having some work done on her. And she's also currently getting her big 6-month service. So obviously these vehicles have quite a hard time, and they need to be
maintained in that. And after 6 months, we often have to do things like bushes and bearings and things like that. And then the third vehicle, the latest in our fleet, is rusty. That's because it had a bit of rust on the chassis when we first got it. And speaking of rusty, Jamie's driving Rusty this morning, and Rusty was actually brought in as a backup vehicle to Wendy and Jigger, and also Andrew's quite fond of Rusty because when the drone is up and operational, that is Andrew's throne as drone commander. He sits on the back of Rusty and likes to think he's very important while he zooms around in the air. Speaking of Rusty, Rusty has a wild animal with a heartbeat. So let's go have a look what Rusty's got.
Our wild animals are playing particularly camera shy, but we've got a lovely herd of Inyala that we see quite regularly on this road. One of them has been highly entertaining in the past, dashing around and just generally playing. That's a female that you're looking at there, that light tan color. There's a little male in the front as well, but they're not playing nice this morning. They're obviously feeling a little bit camera shy. Maybe they woke up with a bad hair day. Hey, Inyalas, can you stop? Stop, don't disappear. Ah, the joys. Live wildlife filming. There we go. The last view of those Inyala, unfortunately, that I think we're going to get. They've decided to move off into the thickest vegetation they could possibly find. Now, a couple of days ago, I was with Tebs actually. Tebs and myself were driving, having just had the most spectacular black mamba sighting. And we came upon quite a mysterious scene, which was a dead Inyala with a bataleer feeding off her. And we went off and we doubled and we tried to see I actually thought it was a kill at first. I was trying to see if we could find the predator attached to it. There was no sign of any predation on it. But Safari Dean, you were wondering if maybe it was possible that a leopard or karuna in particular had broken that Inyala's neck or killed it and then been scared away by elephants before they had she had a chance to devour it. That's an entirely possible option. Now, I couldn't see any signs of bites around the neck, but the carcass was quite decomposed and there were some scars and some old patches that could maybe have been puncture wounds or signs of a struggle. It's very difficult to tell. That's as likely a theory as any one of the ones that we came up with. Hello, boy. We've actually got a nice Inyala who's going to quite possibly walk behind that bush, but having seen that female, for new viewers, it's always nice to have a look at the difference between the males and the females. You can see that much, much darker coat with the tan stockings. Only the male Inyalas have horns as well. This is a nice, impressive big male. They're also much fluffier than the females, and the reason behind that is it adds to their intimidation factor. So when a male Inyala fights, or is going to fight, they do what's known as piloerection, where they fluff up all of the fur along their back and their tail and make themselves look nice and big to look more intimidating for other males. Let's go forward a little bit. Maybe he's gonna come out and still play nice. It's very, very common to see these Inyala, and they tend to habituate to people really nicely. And you often see them in camp gardens and where the lawns are watered, so the food is nice. And Owen Tube, you were wondering, welcome, by the way, to our safari family. And please keep sending through your questions. You were wondering if it's ever likely that the Inyala would attack. And the answer is no. They are far more scared of us than we should ever be of them. That being said, perhaps it would be a good idea for that question to also be sent through to Brent, who has had quite an interesting Inyala experience over the last few days. That is the absolute... That's all I'm going to say. I'm going to leave it to him to tell the story behind it, because it is entertaining, but I don't want to steal his thunder, and I'm sure he will enjoy another retelling of that particular story. But Owen Chu, no. With all of the antelope species, they tend to be very wary of people. They generally avoid any kind of confrontation. Inyala do habituate to people more easily than some of the other antelope species, and that means that they sometimes come into conflict. So if an Inyala like that was to be cornered or felt threatened, then it might try and defend itself. And they're quite big animals. It's important to remember with all wild animals that they are much, much stronger than us. They have faster reflexes. And I've had one encounter with an Inyala male where my puppy was still learning. She grew up with Inyala wandering around all the time, and she wanted to play. So she went up to investigate this particular male, and he decided that actually he really didn't like her and charged her. She went racing back to the safety of Mom, which at that point happened to be me. She shot between my legs, and the Inyala bull was so caught up in his charge that he sort of stopped there in front of me. With me standing down, it's probably one of the most frightening charges I've ever had in my life, which is ridiculous because I've been charged by lots of things. But this one, you know, when you're shouting and clapping and trying to tell the thing to stop, and it's so distracted, you actually start to wonder if you're about to get smacked by an Inyala, which would be very unusual. I mean, the only person I know of who's actually had a very close encounter with an Inyala is Brent. But Owen Tube, you'll have to just stay tuned for that particular story. I don't want to steal Brent's thunder. Good morning, Hornbills. Oh. We're just going to get the display of these two hornbills. I think they might do their little head bob. Come on, guys. For new viewers, work on your bird list. Being very vocal. These two red bulls. There we go. This is a mated pair that are displaying to each other and the other hornbills in the area. I'm not sure if that other red bull with them is one of their previous offspring. It could well be. Hornbills stick around with their parents even after they've grown up, and they help them with their nests and to raise the next set of chicks. It's known as cooperative breeding. And it sounds as though Brent has found another unusual bird to show you.
So I know a lot of our birders out there, we've been trying to get a good view of this kingfisher species for you. I know it's not the best, but it could be a new one for your list. So we're just going to get a safety shot from here. It's a grey hooded kingfisher. So definitely the most rare of the Hallison kingfisher species we get here. You can see his head bobbing. I'm going to try to sneak a bit closer. And hopefully we'll get a nice view. Mike in Florida was really looking for this bird to add to his bird list. So hopefully Mike is watching this morning and can add the uncommon grey hooded kingfisher. Ah, oh, the fool. But you haven't gone far. Andrew, you better be on fire now. Back. See where he went. Oh, he's done it. Ducker. Such a pity. Anyway, we did get a little view of him there, a grey hooded kingfisher. So we haven't been able to find any of these male leopard tracks. And you guys have been having quite a discussion about an experience VM and I had last weekend. Actually, I think it's a week today. It was a Saturday last week. I wasn't attacked by a Niniana per se. Was leaped upon. It was one of those fluke things that happens. VM was kindly giving me a lift back to my house and in the rain, and I didn't feel like walking in the rain. And as we drove out of the Juma research camp, the wild dogs which were chasing an Inyana, and an adult female jumped through VM's passenger window and landed on my lap and got stuck between the windscreen and me, kicked me up quite a bit, so it did some good work on my ribs, back of my head, and also had lots of shards of glass stuck in my legs. Actually, one came out only yesterday, and unfortunately we weren't filming when it happened, but if you want to have a look at the aftermath, if you just go to my Facebook page, you will see there's a little video there showing what happened to VM's car. And the female Inyana is a surprisingly big animal when it's on top of you, but to cut a long story short, eventually I managed to grab its back legs and pop it on my lap. VM said it looked like I was holding a big dog. Imagine I had Inyana around the waist like this to stop those hooves kicking me, and I then just turfed her out the window. I couldn't open the door due to the fact that from the impact of the Inyana, the door was jammed shut. But yeah, quite a scary experience, and we were very, very lucky to come out as unscathed as we did. Could have been a lot worse, and thankfully it was a female and not a male. And I'm not sure what happened to that Inyana, but it ran off at speed after being turfed out the window. So, not sure what happened to it after that. Awesome One, who is a new viewer, we welcomed onto the live drive a little bit earlier, says this is something I've got to start watching more often. We agree wholeheartedly, and welcome to the Safari Live family. YouTube says, are they just looking for tracks or are they actually looking for the real animal? Well, it's not generally, if you keep following the tracks, if you're lucky, you'll find the animal creating them. So we are looking for the animal, and the best way to find a lot of these animals out here in the bush is to track them. So, and especially in the early morning like we are now, while it's nice and cool, the tracks are nice and fresh, the wind hasn't blown, it hasn't moved them, so we're able to find what direction that animal's been going, and hopefully the end goal is to find that animal. And also, Scott is having a nap this morning, in a well-deserved little rest, so we rotate, and my name is Brent, and that's Andrew Joseph, whose hands you see occasionally appearing behind my head. There we go, like that. And of course on the other vehicle is Jamie and Tebs this morning. Speaking of striped animals, so the cousin, and Alyssa's referring and asking after the cousin of the Inyala, the kudu, said she hasn't seen any pregnant herds of kudu recently. Are they around? They are around. I actually saw, when did we see? I saw some kudu yesterday. I think it was after, when I was out tracking. They are around, and could be pregnant at any time of the year. They're not them, Inyala and Bushbuck, who are all sort of cousins, Trafalgar's spiral horned antelope. They all give birth at any time of the year and are not fixed on a cycle like wildebeest and impala. So let's see if we can find the queen of the juba. Austin, seems like great minds think alike. Austin, who's 13, was asking, are kudu and Inyala related? Well spotted. You can see they're of a similar family, and Bushbuck is the final sort of one we get and see here regularly of the spiral horned antelope family. So good observation skills there, Austin. And the Trafalgar's happen to be a favorite of mine, not when they're jumping through the window, of course, but probably I think my favorite antelope is the Bushbuck. Incredible little guys, very, very beautiful. Scott and Nikki have been making friends with a Bushbuck. I don't know if you guys saw the video by Scott. He was going for a shower one evening, in the outside shower, and a Bushbuck beat him to it and was having a nap inside his shower. One of the fun things about living in the bush is all those little things that happen to us. To be privileged to live in this wild area. Chatting about spiral horned antelope, Erwin Tube would like to know, what is an Inyala's main food source? Perfect. So one of their favorite foods is this little very bright tree growing right next to us. And if we have a look, you can actually see where the broken branches are to the right, where it's been a little bit up there, Andrew. There we go. It's been nipped. It is a buffalo thorn. So Inyalas are browsers, so that means they eat leaves. So they feed on quite a wide host of different tree species, but this being one of their favorites. And imagine that while we stop there. There's a sunbird nest. You see it, Andrew?
Yeah.
Here we go. It looks like a little white-bellied sunbird's nest. Just going to have a closer look. See where the entrance is. Got to be careful because this buffalo thorn that it's in, it's got very sharp hooked thorns. And this one doesn't look like it's used. It looks like it's a bit old. And the entrance is on the other side, but it's getting a bit thin around the bottom and stuff, so I don't think this is in use at the moment. So quite a lot of the sunbirds, interestingly enough, will build nests like that, and they'll even collect and harvest spider webs, and they use the spider webs to stick the nest together. So it's made up of dry leaves and grass and twigs and that, but all stuck together by using spiders' webs. Oh, what do you got there, Andrew? Spider. Oh, there we go. There's a community spider nest. Well spotted, Andrew. And obviously, probably got harvested quite heavily for the building of that little sunbird nest. I think I just saw a spider walking along there, but there we go. So there's this community spider nest, and there's the sunbird nest. Now, community spiders are one of the few communal or group living spiders in the world, and they live in small little colonies. So Sailor, the new viewer, is now getting into the question asking, and Sailor would like to know, do the buffalo like this tree if it's called a buffalo thorn? Well, that is very true. So buffalo are generally grazers, so they eat grass, but occasionally one of the trees they will eat is buffalo thorn. Have another little, I'm just gonna collect a little branchlet of that buffalo thorn and tell you guys a story while we continue to search for leopards. So it's a very important tree in quite a lot of the Nguni cultures in southern Africa. One, this final one has got a really nice example of what I want to show you. We'll take a dry branch, not a green one. Oh, but before we leave it, also, if you ever want to add something extra to your salad while you're out in the bush, nice and tasty. That's why all the animals like it. And it is edible to humans, as you can see. Yum, 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 yum. And pop that there. So, before we get moving, I'll show you quickly. See, buffalo thorn is quite unique in the fact it's got one straight thorn and one hooked thorn. So, hooked thorn, straight thorn. And that will become very important in the story I'm about to tell you. So, as we move on, I will tell you. So, in quite a few of the Nguni cultures, particularly the Zulu culture, the buffalo thorn is a vessel to transport spirits of departed loved ones. So, when loved ones die away from their traditional home, a family member will be sent to the area where they've been buried that is away from their traditional home. And what will happen is a buffalo thorn branch, probably a little bit bigger than this one, will be chosen very, very carefully. It will then travel with that family member to the area where their family member has died. It will be placed on the grave. And the hooked thorn captures their spirit into this vessel for transporting loved ones. And then that branch will travel back to their sort of ancestral home. Quite often, so this happens in northern Zululand, where it's sort of quite rural and a lot of traditional beliefs still exist. And so that branch will be transported. That branch will also be after like it as a person. So if I was transporting my family member and I wanted to have a Coke, a cola or a fruit juice, I would then also buy the branch of fruit juice. When I bought a meal for myself, I'd then buy a meal for the spirit. And if I'm taking a bus, I would buy a bus ticket and the branch would have its own seat in the bus. Really, really fascinating. So then once that's spirit is returned home and traveled and been treated exactly like a human would. It is in proper old Zulu tradition. There's an ancestral hut where the ancestors live in it. Normally the closest to the sort of cattle kraal and where that's the ancestors. The Zulus really love their cows. And it would be the closest hut there. This branch will then be placed in that ancestral hut or even in the cattle kraal in some cases, and the straight thorn will release the spirit again. So the hooked thorn catches the spirit and then that long straight thorn will release the spirit, and it can go join the rest of its ancestors and its ancestral home. So absolutely fascinating there, that the buffalo thorn also got another quite a fun name after quite a serious story about dead things or dead people in Afrikaans, which is a language we have here in South Africa that's a derivative of Dutch. It's called a wag a bietjie bos. Actually, it's called a blink vlaar wag a bietjie bos. Basically, that means a shining leaved wait a bit tree. It's called a wait a bit tree because of these thorns. And if you get stuck in it, you have to wait quite a bit while you remove yourself or extricate yourself from those thorns. I missed that. The Game Drive radio was going, so I'm just... Mike, I know you were asking something. I'm just checking. Give a second. Ah, there we go. Mike was asking, what is a weight of a plant? There we go. It is the buffalo thorn. For those of you who like to go a little bit more fancy-smancy, the scientific name is Sisyphus macronatum. So Jamie's just trying to get hold of me on the radio. Standing by, Jamie. Alright, negative, go for it. I'm on my way back towards Last Tracks now. We had no luck with that audio, so start again. Jogging away. All right, so ground hornbill, an endangered species. I can actually see four at the moment. And oh, there was something, and it was swallowed very quickly. I'm just going to try and move a little bit further forward. Actually, those of you who've been watching or listening to the Juma Dam Cam might have heard them calling this morning. One of the really beautiful and distinctive calls in the African bush. Sort of wonderful. There we go. So an endangered species, there's less than 235 mating pairs left, and very long-lived species, live to about 45 years. And we're going to try have a look if we can see if they're male or female. And it can be quite difficult, especially at this range. I'm just going to use my binos quickly. So that one in shot at the moment. What do you say, Andrew?
I'm going for male.
And I'm afraid Andrew is incorrect.
Oh.
It was a female. The one behind it was a male. Unfortunately, unfortunately, I didn't get a sex on the last one, and it disappeared before I could get it. So the reason we very closely check sexes on ground hornbills is we are part, or we help aid an ongoing project that is obviously with all endangered species. It is quite important to try keep a note on them and keep a note on numbers. So if we have a look here, so the male, the casque, which is this ridge on the top of the beak, is slightly more prominent, and the female has a blue spot in the middle of her throat. And that's the big difference. So I definitely had one male, one female there. I unfortunately didn't get the sex of the last one. And with a lot of things like endangered species, we're not going to sort of harass them at all. We'll just let them be. Hopefully we'll maybe bump into them a little bit later on a more open spot. But endangered species, only 235 breeding pairs. And so we do constantly, if we see them, mark the area we've seen them and the sexes, and send that through to the researchers. And the reason they're so endangered is that when, in the sort of from the 20s onwards, when we didn't really know much about some of the insecticides and poisons we were using to wipe out the farmers, to wipe out sort of crop raiders, a lot of those poisons transferred onto some of your other animals. So oxpeckers and hornbills, ground hornbills in particular, were heavily hit by that. But they're both good news. Both their numbers are coming up slowly. My like sandmires. It can a ground hornbill break through a tortoise shell? Most definitely. You look at that massive beak, they're able to sort of crack them open. Of course, very uncomfortable if you're a tortoise, but it's a really nice big meal if you're a hornbill. So, I'm just checking here. The last tracks of Madame Karula I had were over there before we rushed off to go see if we could find that male who was calling. So Karula loves a termite mound, and there's a couple of nice ones in the distance. I just want to have a quick look, see if she's not resting on top of one. She's not. Termite mounds, the reason a leopard loves a termite mound is it gives them a wonderful high vantage point so they can look for potential prey or potential threats. So I'm going to have a quick look here. The last tracks were just here. So while we do that, Wayne in Philadelphia would like to know, do they roar or purr? So Wayne's actually brought up quite an interesting thing. Cats that can roar can't purr, and cats that can purr can't roar. Aha, isn't that amazing? So a leopard, it's called sawing, but it is a form of roaring. And the cat species that belong to the family Panthera, which is your large cats, are generally the ones that can roar. So lion, leopard, jaguar, tiger, and your others are the ones that purr. And there's a very beautiful torchwood tree, or Balanites morgami, also sometimes known as a green thorn. I'm still just trying to find that last petite and the beautiful little leopard track of Karula, the Queen of Juma. And there we go, there she is, that's the last track right there. So I'm going to get Andrew to show it to you. There you go, there's Karula's little footprint. And Monkey Man, aka Joey, who's in Australia, would like to know if a lot of the animals react negatively to the upright, the bipedal figure of man as the dominant diurnal predator. Is it possible that if we crawled on all fours, would we elicit a different reaction? Most definitely, Joey, that would happen. And the problem is we're not really good on all fours, so sometimes it might be a negative thing. It might still move away. And when you're walking with non-predatory species, so your herbivores, if you walk upright and straight past them, they know we're not like a lion. We can't run fast enough to catch them. We have to rely on our brain to. So as soon as you start stalking, you start displaying predatory behavior, which will actually cause them to run away. With predators, it also probably would be a little bit, sorry, I just, the game drive channel's going off there. I just want to listen quickly before I take a walk. But no. While I'm going to go walk and see where the last track of Karula actually disappears to, we're going to go join Jamie, who's on her way to a different spotted animal.
So I'm trying to be
And while Brent goes off in search of Karula, you've come across at just the right time as we make our way towards the spotted hyena den. My favorite predator to sit and watch, always entertaining. And let's keep our fingers crossed that the newest members of the Hyena Clan decide to make an appearance this morning. Notice lots and lots of hyena tracks wandering around where the lions had that kill this morning. The hyenas have been moving through that area. They also wander across towards where that dead hippo was, although I think that carcass is now largely eaten. Good morning, smellies. How are you? Who have we got here? This is so fascinating. It really, really is. I'm talking about the dynamic between the matriarch and her older cub, Bella. Oh, sorry, not Bella. Yes, Bella. Look at this. This is so interesting. Good morning, smelly one, two, and three. So we've got June lying down in the front. Hello. Hello, mischief. Are you sleepy? Did you have a long night? What were you up to? Hello. Looking good, huh? Oh, just at the age where it's going to be wandering around. But have a look up at what's happening here. There's the new mom, the matriarch of this particular clan, a hyena I like to call Madam. Now, she's got two brand new cubs. And yet, there is, well, like, it's hard for me to confirm exactly, but I'm fairly certain that that's Bella lying with her. And that is so interesting because it shows the bond between mother and her suspected son. How strong that is. Is she going to call? Come on, big girl. A nice call for us. She's looking down into the entrance of the den to see if her little new cubs will pop out. So for those of you new to the hyena den, they hide their cubs in these tunnels in termite mounds. As a way of protecting them. And the entrances to the holes are big enough for the mothers to lie in the entrance, but they get progressively narrower as you go into the tunnel. This is actually a really beautiful den site. It's all nicely shaded, as Tebs just showed us. A perfect place for them. Good morning, guys. You've been sleepy. And as always, Madam looks particularly well-fed. Not sure what she was up to last night. Yes, I'm talking about you. No sign of the other two moms. So for new arrivals, or new viewers, the Spotted Hyena Clan, the one at this active den site, we've got three sets of cubs, all under the age of about 3 months old, hiding in this termite mound. And there, a couple of them are just at the stage where they're starting to get their spots. November and the December twins. Oh, my word. There's the pungent odor washing over us. Now, I love spotted hyenas, but they're not the most hygienic of creatures. Goodness me, this den is really starting to acquire quite the scent. And essentially what happens is the cubs themselves defecate and urinate around the den. Often the females bring back, or the young sub-adults bring back, bits of carcass to chew on. They also always are anal pasting around the den, which is something that is very intrinsic to hyena society. And what that means is that over time the den site acquires quite the odor, and at that point, the hyenas will have to move. I'm glad you guys are all happy that we've come to the hyena den. I love to check in every couple of days just to see what's happening, because you never know when they decide to move, just due to that buildup of parasites, and move off, and it'll take us a while before we find the new den site, unless we get lucky and they use one of the previous ones. Have a look, since we've been carrying on a theme of tracks and feet, you can actually have a look at the little paws of that one sub-adult. You can see the pads. I was looking at Bella. Yeah, we won't be able, I think June shifted, so we won't be able to see But there you can see the little feet. Look at the way that those toes all tessellate. They all fit together, making almost like a puzzle piece. Awesome, thank you, Tebs. And there you can sort of see the what I was chatting a bit about with that lion track and with Caitlin and Kayla's question about three lobes and two lobes. Hyenas is the clearest example of the two lobes at the back. So that back pad that I'm chatting about behind the toes, you can see how clearly defined the two lobes are at the back. And you can actually also, really nicely in hyenas in particular, you can really see the size difference between the front and the back feet, even on a sub-adult like Bella. The front feet, and it's particularly pronounced in hyena, the front feet and their shoulders are much bigger than their back ends. And that's because it provides muscle attachments for those powerful bone-crushing jaws that they have. You'll also be able to see it in the tracks themselves. They crosswalk, unlike any other animal. Now, I've said that most animals have larger front feet than they have back feet when we were chatting earlier. There is an exception to that in the predators. And I'm fairly certain our regular viewers will know what it is. But I'm going to offer it up to you as a quiz anyway. Which particular predator has larger back feet than it has front feet? Bonus point if you can get the antelope species that has larger back feet than it does front feet. Two different examples. Let's see if you can let me know what you think. Hello, madam. Now we're looking at one of the top predators in this reserve, and it's fascinating always. It's one of the interactions that's the most incredible to watch, is the interaction between the different species of predators. Now out here, these spotted hyenas are in serious competition with the lions, and it generally is a numbers game. If there's lots of hyenas, as there is in this clan, they've got a much better chance. We were actually chatting last night to some of the guides on Simbombili, just as an interesting aside. And apparently the clan on in and around Elephant Plains is absolutely enormous. And they're regularly chasing lions away from the area. So how interesting is that? I mean, obviously the guys are still seeing lions, but they're getting to see some really incredible predator interactions between the two of them. Oh, such a sleepy cub. Did you have a long night last night? What were you up to? Were you munching on buffalo? This little cub is close to 8 months old now. Maybe 9 months old, depending. It was still a tiny little black ball of fluff when I started working here in July. Now, Michael Fleetwood, just on the subject of predator interaction, so for new viewers, all predators will, in their interaction, attempt to kill the offspring of another. It depends on the situation, obviously, but if they see an opportunity, they will take it. And the reason behind that is it reduces the competition for them and their own offspring. So Michael Fleetwood wants to know whether or not leopards ever kill hyena cubs. Now, I would not be at all surprised if there are recorded examples. Personally, I've never seen it. But we have seen Tingana, that big male, dominant male leopard, we have seen him enter straight into a warthog burrow before and pull out a warthog. Is there any reason why they wouldn't be able to do that with hyena cubs? Tunnels are a little bit tinier and the cubs themselves construct nice shelves. But I wouldn't be surprised if there are recorded cases where leopards have killed spotted hyena cubs. It's a general rule of competition out here that they will take opportunities if they have them. All curled up. June's getting a bit big to fit into the den. Another interesting idea, something that we don't, or I hadn't actually considered, but a really good question from James Richards, who was wondering whether baboons would ever raid a hyena den. My suggestion would be no, but baboons are not animals to be trifled with. So if there is ever competition between hyenas and baboons, it would be incredibly interesting to witness. There's lots and lots of stories of leopards and baboons coming into conflict, and there are even recorded cases of large male baboons killing leopards. They are, despite the fact that they are omnivores and they often sit and eat fruit and pluck fruit from the trees, they are really quite fiercely powerful, and a big male baboon could quite easily challenge a leopard in terms of access, and they do like to eat meat. They've got canines that are larger than a leopard. In fact, I've seen some baboons that look like they would rival lions in their tooth department. So really big, powerful animals. Whether or not they would deliberately raid a hyena den, I would suggest not. Generally, hyenas are more powerful than leopards, particularly female leopards. A big male leopard could maybe challenge a hyena. But for a big female hyena sitting at around close to 60, 70 kilograms, which is about 140 odd pounds, I don't think a baboon would raid a hyena den. I don't know for certain, though. It seems unlikely to me. I don't think that they would risk having to be that vulnerable on the ground without the option of being able to escape back up into a tree away from a defensive mother hyena. And I know often the cubs are left alone during the day. The mothers tend to move off, find a nice shady spot in a drainage line. I don't know, though. I'll check in with the other presenters, see if they've ever heard of any cases like that. I'd be curious to know. Now, this spotted hyena clan we've become very familiar with, but there's another hyena species that I think we would be absolutely jumping up and down if we ever had a chance to see them. And Austin, who is 13, he wanted to know about the different species of hyena. So the other hyena species that we get out here is a brown hyena. Now, it's quite unusual to see them in this particular area of the Sabi Sands. They like to find nice rockier areas, and they are fairly outcompeted by the spotted hyenas here. But you never know. I know that one was seen on a live safari once. You just never know when one might decide to wander through. They're much more nomadic than these spotted hyenas tend to be, and they wander far and wide. But Austin, I'm going to show you a picture of what a... Are the cubs coming out? No. I'm going to show you a picture of the brown hyena, and then I'm going to chat a little bit about the other species that we get. So this is the brown hyena. Very, very similar in size, slightly smaller than our spotted hyenas, but with a very brown, shaggy coat. They look, in the darkness, I've often noticed they sort of almost look like collies. They're about the same size as a collie dog, and with that thick fur, almost looks similar. And their tracks, in brown hyena, if you ever want to tell the difference between spotted and brown hyena, their tracks are, the size difference is more pronounced. So their front feet are enormous, their back feet are tiny, tiny. It almost looks as though they're walking with a cub. That difference is so pronounced. And just to give you a sense of scale, actually, since this is a nice picture of it, we've got a nice comparison here. This is the average size man, I assume, probably slightly bigger than I am. You can see how the spotted hyena sits in relation to brown hyena. Roughly similar in size, but the spotted hyena is much bulkier. And interestingly, the spotted hyena is the only species of hyena with the females being dominant and having those pseudo penises. Brown hyenas don't have that at all. So that's what makes their evolution so interesting. One last picture to show you. A species that has been fiercely argued in terms of whether or not it belongs in the hyena family, and actually has a different Latin name. So the hyenas fall under the Crocuta Latin name. The aardwolf is completely separate to it, but still included within the family due to the structure of the feet as well as the structure of the anal glands. But little aardwolves are very, very different. They're much smaller, and their diet is entirely termite-based. So something unusual. You can see they don't have the same powerful bone-crushing jaws because they don't need to. They've evolved to eat termites. Now, Brent was having quite a long discussion with some of the other guides in the area as to whether or not they've ever seen Aardvark. Apparently, the crew has seen Aardvark twice driving from here to Manuleti, and Brent thinks that he saw Aardvark tracks in the sand. So can you imagine if we came round the corner one evening and found an Aardvark sitting in the road? It would be epic. One other hyena species that we don't get here is a striped hyena, and that's much further north up into Africa. So they don't occur here, but roughly similar in size to the spotted hyenas and the brown hyenas. And for new viewers, I chatted and I touched a little bit on the females being bigger. And yes, in spotted hyenas, the females are much bigger and stronger. Where are you off to, Bella? Going for a wander. The hyena at the entrance to the den, still lying, looking very peaceful. Come on, girls. We need to see your cubs now. We need to see your babies. And well done to Terry, Donna, and Siberia Zuni, and lots of others. You've got the answer to my quiz right for the larger back pad, oh sorry, the larger back feet of a predator. You are absolutely correct. It is indeed the cheetah. And cheetahs' back feet are considerably larger than their front feet. And if you think about the way that they're adapted to run and to sprint, you can see why. It is an increase in traction. And Donna, Natasha, and Jared, you've suggested for the antelope species that it's a kudu. But now what's interesting about this quiz is that I've actually caught myself out, because I'm not sure whether kudu's back feet are bigger than their front feet. I was thinking of blue wildebeest, but maybe kudu do. I don't think so, though. Blue wildebeest, particularly in the males, their back feet are rounder and larger than the front feet, and that's partly because they actually spend quite a lot of time with their interdigital gland that sits between the halves of the hoof. They've got a scent gland there, or a pedal gland, that they scrape along the ground, and that's actually worn away the front part of their track. And although their back track is larger, it's also rounder than the front track from that scraping. Kudu, I don't think so, but maybe I'm wrong. Caught myself out there. I'm going to go check. Next time I see a kudu, I'm going to go and examine its feet really closely, see if I can have a look at its tracks as it walks. I'm trying to picture it in my head. I've seen kudu tracks so many times, and they register, so they fall on, the back foot falls over the front foot. So it should be fairly easy to see if they, no, I don't think so with kudu. Their front halves are so big, particularly in the males, with all of that weight. We'll have to double check. I better fact check myself. I've given you a quiz that I'm not sure about the answer to. Bella's wandered off somewhere. I don't know where he's gone. About the size difference with the females. Eric in Virginia Beach, you've asked a question that actually nobody really knows the answer to. So Eric wants to know why are spotted hyenas such an exception to that general rule? In most of the mammal species, almost all of the mammal species, the male is bigger than the female. So why have spotted hyena evolved with the females having such high levels of androgen, testosterone, essentially evolving reproductive organs that make what they are intended purposes for incredibly difficult? So the females, especially new mothers, really, really struggle to give birth through those pseudo penises. So Eric, there's a couple of theories. The predominant one is the big mother theory. So in order, the theory sort of goes that in order to compete, particularly with lions, in terms of reproductive success and numbers, because obviously the more hyena, the more you can compete. And particularly given in certain areas the nomadic lifestyle of the spotted hyenas. Not less so here, but more in the desert areas. The animals have to travel far and wide. And what that's led to is mothers trying to produce offspring, feeding them the best and the highest protein content milk. So the bigger the animal, the bigger the female, the better they can produce that milk. The further they can range, the more access to food they can gobble and then return back to their cubs and feed them and give them the best milk. So that's the big mother theory. It's quite difficult to explain, and I don't think it fully explains exactly why it is that these hyenas have evolved. I mean, we're currently looking at one of the biggest hyenas I have seen, just not necessarily in terms of height, but in terms of bulk. Madam is particularly large. I think that's what's made her the matriarch, or what's led to her being the matriarch. It's a combination of genetic size factor and then also the fact that she will have had the best access to food throughout her life. Whether or not she has higher levels of testosterone, I'm not entirely sure. She certainly has a swagger to her. But there's the answer to your question, Eric, is that no one really knows exactly what has led to this evolution. It's what makes spotted hyenas so fascinating. And it's tied in to the questions about how it was that they evolved the social structure that they did, with these strict clan hierarchies, with a matriarch or a queen of the clan sitting at the top, and then the subordinates below her. And unrelated hyenas, so different matrilineal lines, all living together in one clan. Makes sense, helps to increase or boost numbers, meaning that they can compete for access to food, especially with lions and the other predators. It's an interesting one. What we do know is that hyenas produce some of the best milk of any of the mammal species out here. And you can see it. You can see it working in practice, the way that the cubs have grown an incredible amount. And even though it's been a while since we've seen June's mother, for example, we're looking at June at the moment, by the way, this little sub-adult lying here, it's been a while since we've seen the mom. That doesn't necessarily mean that she isn't coming to the den. It just means that we haven't been here at times when she does. And for a sub-adult of June's age, she would still be suckling. And that's also another factor, is the fact that hyenas lactate for longer. Because they're bigger, they can afford to. The females can provide, or can get the nutrients needed to provide those high levels of lactation all the way up to about a year old, sometimes even a year and a half, that hyena cubs will lactate. That hyena cubs will be suckling and their mothers will be lactating. It's one of the things that fascinates me. I sit and think about it a lot. Mentioned that I really, really like this den site, and it's so nice and protected. It sits right in a Tamboti thicket. The access to the den is therefore controlled by the hyenas. But Ellen in Arkansas, you were wondering whether or not neighboring clans would ever fight over access to a better den site than others. For example, with nice access to water or maybe a secured spot like this. To the best of my knowledge, they don't really fight so much over den sites, but they will fight over territory. So they often get clan wars, which can be incredibly violent and very serious if rival clans or neighboring clans encounter each other at some point on a territorial boundary. So spotted hyenas are strictly territorial. We've actually worked out pretty much the exact boundary of our Juma clan versus the one that moves across on Arethusa and Elephant Plains. And that sits, there's almost like a no man zone, if that makes sense. Our clan has placed middens all the way up our western boundary on Triple M itself. And the other clan has placed middens, or latrines as they're actually called, where they regularly defecate to mark territorial boundaries. They've put that all along one road to the west of that. So it's like they have a buffer zone almost, if that makes sense. There's really interesting, literally straight lines of latrines all the way along. So they'll fight over better territory, so better access to food, more scavenging opportunities, good water, and maybe within that, Ellen, I suppose, ideal den sites. So yes, in a way, they'll compete for den sites, but not the particular den site. It's more an area where there are possible den sites, if that makes sense. This is a really nice den. There's a hole on the left that is generally where Pretty and Corky tend to, so the two mothers of the older cubs, they tend to spend time there. And the tunnel links all the way through to the right-hand tunnel. Oh, I just wanted to check in with our hyenas. They're not up to much at the moment, so let's go and have a look at Brent's bird of prey.
So, unfortunately, no luck with the leopard, but we've got another apex predator, an apex predator of the air. And it's not one we've seen for a while. And I wonder if our birders out there can guess what it is. And if you do know, send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv. Or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Really big eagle, but which big eagle?
Why don't you give us three choices at least?
Oh, Andrew. That would be giving away too much of the game. Got to keep our viewers sharp. So beautiful big Aquila eagle. So it is a true eagle. I'll give you that. A hint, should narrow it down for you a little bit. And it's also a resident eagle, so it doesn't migrate. So while you guys try to figure out what that is, we've got another bird questioner from Chris Rogue, who would like to know, are the carmine beaters still around? We've only seen them once with Jamie. And they are, but there are going to be very few of them this year. It's the same reason there's fewer woodlands, kingfishers, fewer European rollers. They're chasing the rain. They need that rain for the burst of insects that it produces. So we might see them again, but they're definitely not as common as they were last wet season. So just a quick update. Unfortunately, Queen Karula, I'm quite confident, has left us for now. She's moved out of our traverse area. We heard Impala alarm calling here, the Impala that were alarm calling, and we rushed to this area. She was also calling when I was on foot following the tracks. We're just behind her, unfortunately, just probably 5 to 10 minutes too late to catch her before she crossed. But with every leopard that leaves, there's a possibility of another arriving. So I'm gonna have a better look for that male that Aubrey heard calling this morning. So I'm checking our southern boundary, and somewhere in this area, see if I can find any tracks. Now what I wonder, Gorilla in the mood for love. Is that why I heard her calling? And there was a male calling. Maybe she's looking to mate again. So it'd be interesting to see and find out if any of the other game drives from surrounding us actually might find her with the male. Natasha and Marianne, you've gone for the bait, hook, line and sinker, saying it is a pale morph warbird's eagle. It's not. It is a pale morph eagle, but not a warbird's. So let's see if anyone can get a bit further than the warbird's. Warbird's is much smaller, and remember, it's got that very distinct little crest on the back of its head. says, is it a juvenile fish eagle? It's not. We have two South Africans who are in Saudi Arabia, Penny and Gerard, who have got it right. Oh, so Penny's in SA, Gerard is in Saudi Arabia, who have got it spot on. It is a pale morphed tawny eagle. So maybe that might not be one some of you had on your bird list. Find it for you there, and I can show you the picture of the Warburgs and why it's not a Warburgs. Vultures, eagles. And on the power line is a European roller, but when it gets to the eagles, they're the vultures, snake eagles. Where have the true eagles decided to migrate out of my book? No, there they are. There we go, a pale morph tawny eagle, also sometimes referred to as a rufous morph. They do have sort of in between. One of the big giveaways just was the shape of the head, very, very rounded, and also the size, it was much, much bigger. But if we have a look at, where's the Warburgs? So we look at the Warburgs. So even on the pale morphs, the wings tend to be a little bit darker, but it's that really distinctive head shape. They've got that appearance of a little crest, and that is a sort of big giveaway there. And the other one that could have been a good gander would have been the steppe eagle, but you don't really get too many pale morphs. And if we look at the gape, which is the important thing, so the gape, the set of the mouth in a steppe eagle, it extends to behind the eye, and it's also got a red eye, where there's the tawny yellow eye, and the gape goes to the middle of the eye. Go. Let us continue. It has definitely felt like someone has turned the heating up, and the temperature changed very rapidly from a very pleasant cool to now probably it's getting hot quickly at the moment. So amazing, all those ellies, there must have been at least 200 elephants on Juma yet during the day yesterday, and now I don't think I will be lucky if there's two. I've seen all the tracks and everywhere I've gone, and they're all heading out, but at this time of the year and with these very dry conditions, the ellies are going to be moving big distances. So while we continue to check the southern boundary, hopefully for a surprise set of tracks coming to visit us, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
All is very, very peaceful here at the den. We've arrived a little bit late in the morning. It's got to nap time already, apparently. Full bellies and peaceful, safe spots to sleep in. Now, looking at this little sub-adult, June is probably about 8 months old. And Mike, you were wondering at what point a young hyena could actually survive without its mother. Now, I think that this is probably about the earliest that a young hyena could survive. They still are dependent on mom for suckling, so they still suckle from their mothers occasionally. That being said, they are eating meat, they are eating solid food, and they are moving out with the clan to go out and scavenge. So we've often seen June wandering around with the rest of the clan members. So she's about big enough to be surviving on its own. Difficult one, because subadult ages, or at the subadult age, it's probably when hyenas are most at risk anyway, because they start to roam further and further from the safety of the den, and they haven't have quite the same level of life experience that the others, the adults, do, and thus aren't maybe as alert as they should be or aware of the dangers that they might encounter. But you're looking probably at about that age. I would say that for absolute security or ensuring the success of a baby, you're probably looking at about 1.5 to 2 where they could exist on their completely on their own. Now, if June's mother is not present, and I'm not saying that that is the case, I'm saying that if that were the case, then she's still got a chance of surviving. She'll follow, she'll stay with the clan, and or he, she or he, would be, she will stay with their clan. So Gordy, you were wondering about where June's mom is. Haven't seen her. It doesn't mean that she's not coming through in the middle of the night. I would love to be a fly on the wall at this hyena den at all times. Have eyes and ears here to watch what's happening. But I think that June would be more than capable of surviving, if necessary. I'm not sure. It's a difficult one. They can spend as much time as possible with their mothers. I've said that they are one of my favorite creatures out here. And Nicole, who's watching in Memphis, you wanted to know if I've ever touched a hyena. And yes, I have. I generally tend to follow as much of a hands-off policy as possible. However, I have been involved in game capture with both spotted hyena and with brown hyena. Nicole, I've told the story a couple of times where we were called in because we thought that a spotted hyena had been snared at a den site, which in hindsight would actually have been very, very unlikely. It wasn't in this area, it was further towards the Drakensberg Mountains. But what had actually happened was the cupboard had jumped up and hooked its foot in a raisin bush and was dangling from it. And since we were there and we were watching and this thing was struggling, it couldn't get any upwards momentum to get its foot out. We jumped out and we wrapped a jacket around the cub's head, because even at the smallest age, they'd be more than capable of biting your finger and probably breaking the bones in it. We wrapped its head in a jacket, lifted it out, and dropped it, let it go, put the jacket off, and immediately left it to go back into the den. So in that respect, I've also been on game capture where the farmer, or neighboring farmer on the reserve that I was on, had called us in, and one of his workers, it was something that the reserve encouraged. So instead of farmers shooting what they considered to be threats to their livestock, whether fair or unfairly, they had a policy that if they caught them, or if they had them reported them, the reserve would go and dart them and remove them and bring them onto the reserve. And in this particular case, it was a brown hyena. Because we had her under sedation, it was quite a long journey that she had to travel. We had to lift her into the crate. We also notched the ear to try and be able to identify her in future. And I got to spend a lot of time examining the way that their feet move, the coarseness of their fur, the smelliness, admittedly, but still amazing animals. And then I sat in the back of the, what we call in South Africa, a bucky, which is a, what would you call it? It's a sort of pickup truck, basically, a nice open flat back truck. I sat in the back with her and watched her wake up just to make sure that everything was okay. She didn't try and injure herself trying to get out of the crate, because at that point we would have had to sedate her. Released her onto the reserve and she disappeared. I think it was a hard release, actually. A soft release. So she was in a boma for a while to get used to it, to try and make sure that she didn't go back to her original home, which is what a lot of animals tend to want to do. When they are released into a new area, when there's that level of interference, they try and move back to where they've come from. So what people do is they put them in a slightly smaller fenced enclosure where they spend a couple of months getting used to where they are before releasing them. Depends on the species of animal. Works for some, doesn't work for others. In this case, she disappeared and wasn't seen or heard about again. I've just started the engine. I was going to leave, but June is up. To me, still looking a little bit thin. Oh, you've got sleepy wobbles. Just wanted to move into a nicer spot. Yep. Tucking back in. Blocking the light with its leg. All right. Bye-bye, Smelly. Enjoy your afternoon nap. And since I'm calling him Smelly, Christopher, you wanted to know if hyenas or if spotted hyenas are the worst smelling animals. Christopher, they've got some serious competition. Look, they're quite high up there on the rank of smelly. Let's think. I don't know if I could do a smell ranking. Waterbuck are very, very stinky. It's not a terrible smell. It's a sort of a wet dog kind of scent to it. And I find that you adapt to those sorts of smells if you've worked out here for a long time, and they don't tend to bother you at all. So, yes, waterbuck are quite smelly. Wild dog can be particularly smelly. Lions, let me tell you something. If a lion's been feeding on a buffalo carcass for 4 days and munching on rotten meat, they can be incredibly pungent. What are the other smelly animals? Elephants smell lovely to me. Best smelling animal dung, in my opinion, if you really want to know my ranking. My favorite animal dung to smell is that of a black rhino. It's a beautiful, fresh, I don't know how to describe it. It's got a lovely scent to it. It's just such a, I don't know if it's because I associate that smell with the animal and it's one of my favorite animals. But yes, black rhino dung, top of the list of good smelling smells out here. Smelly animals, mongoose. Mongoose are smelly. Mongoose are pretty stinky. They anal paste on each other with fairly regular, with monotonous regularity. So that carries quite a pungent scent. And if anyone was ever thinking about having a mongoose as a pet, not that we ever encourage such things, but they will also anal paste on their humans. It's a way of showing their bonding to the rest of the group. So strong smells. I've seen leopards. I mean, leopards are quite not a bad smelling animal. I've seen them roll in lion scat. You were wondering about jackals. You were wondering if they have quite a bad smell. I don't think I've ever smelt a jackal. Oh, Gerard, you know that they have a bad smell. Thank you. Sorry, I didn't realize what you were asking, but you say they do have a bad smell. Yes, that makes sense. I think if I'm completely honest, most things out here carry their own unique scent. Zebra, you get the fresh scent of grass wafting over you due to the nature of their digestive system. Same goes for elephants. And Eric. Eric is watching in Virginia Beach. You've come up with a new acronym for your dung challenge. Eric has suggested DRC, the Dung Recognition Challenge. There's something that's actually, I should really get this going now. Now that Brent and Scott are both back, Steph didn't want to play along. So Eric's Dung Recognition Challenge essentially consists of blindfolding the presenter concerned and placing before them the vast array of products of defecation, let's put it that way, in front of us. And at that point, we won't do it by taste, obviously, but maybe by smell and by feel, the guides have to identify the dung, and the winner gets to keep the dung. Is there no better prize? I love it. Maybe this is something we should get going now. It could be quite interesting. Some of the antelope dung will be really difficult to do blindfolded. Eric, I'll have a chat. Let's see if we can get Scott and Brent on board. Maybe we can play a good game of dung recognition. Oh, and I seem to remember a requirement of it was that the dung has to be fresh. Oh, my goodness. Let's see how that suggestion goes down. And while I head off in search of other things, let's pop over to Brent for an update.
So it sounds like my girlfriend is talking a lot about poo. It's a little bit worrying. I'm not quite sure if I'm in on the dung recognition, but I also heard she was talking about anal pasting in mongoose. And growing up, I've had as a family, we've had a few pet banded mongoose. And when we used to get visitors away from the bush, the first thing Lord Montague the mongoose used to do was anal paste on their feet, which sent quite a lot of silly dwellers jumping up in yelps and screams, which only provided to make Lord Montague very excitable and ended up biting a lot of them on their toes. Having pets of the unusual can be very nice, but also it does come with a few less than normal behavior aspects. So the reason they do it to people is because you are now their business, you are their family. So anyone who comes into your territory, especially with males, needs to be added to the family. If he doesn't like you, or you don't want to let him do it, it can lead to a vicious attack. And even though mongoose are quite small, they do have very, very sharp teeth. Oh, it's going to see it. It might fly. Tiny little bird. You left. Oh, there it goes.
As soon as I got it,
it's a little blue wax bill. Now, since we don't have any big cat tracks to follow, let's give a little tracking lesson. And you see what I'm looking at, Andrew?
Yeah.
That little looks like a little triangle almost on the side of the road. I'm gonna jump out now. There we go. Maybe go to the one a little bit further back so I can actually see the gaps between them. Or is it maybe we need to just be actually more above it? The gate. How's that? Okay. So, very distinct little set of tracks here. And the ones we're looking at are these here. And it's, you can see four different feet. That's the back, the hind legs, and those are the front legs. And there's a couple of different species that always, or not always, but quite often make a track like this when they're on the move. So it's always the two back are a little bit wider, and then the two front almost like that. It almost always forms a little triangle you can draw up, and a triangle in the direction that they're going. So from this size, I know what one of those three species it is. It's one of the more common species that we get out here, one of the little ones, but I think it's going to be too easy to tell you what it is right off the bat. So let's see who can try to figure out what it is. We haven't seen one this morning. I wonder if Andrew even knows what it is, Andrew.
Of course I know.
Of course he knows. Well, what we'll do is once we get a few answers from you guys, we'll get Andrew to answer first, and we'll see how clever he is, or how clever he thinks he is. So there we go. And if you want to play the track ID, remember, if you think you know what it is, send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So what I'm doing is I'm back on the quarantine clearings. Because there are some marula fruit, and the ones that have fallen to the ground might start ripening a little bit earlier, even though most of them are rock hard and green at the moment. I'm hoping that although all the big breeding herds of elephants have departed for different area at the moment, we could still get some bulls around, and there have been really really enjoying the quarantine area. So I was hoping maybe we can find a nice early bull here. And this is a magnificently beautiful straight part of the road. And I think it was, when was it? Was it New Year's Eve? It was New Year's Eve. The great race of the Sabi Sands took place here. James, I'm Slow Hendry, or James the Tortoise Hendry, and Brent the Hare Leo Smith took in a live sprint to see who was the fastest person at Juma. And obviously, much to James's shock and horror. I really did think I was going to lose that. Oh, you are lying now, Andrew. We have reviewed the footage. There was no false start. Yes. James was very insistent on reviewing the footage. There's quite a strong competitive streak that runs through both of us. Like to know what happened to the Pride and Scarface. We're joking, Scarface, we could almost also nickname him Al Pacino, but I think we'll stick with Scarface. They moved off to the east, Matthew. So as I said, I was worried that they wouldn't be around for too much longer, because where they were, the closest water was to the east outside of our travel zone. So I know Aubrey from Gallagher, they can drive there, and he's busy looking for those lions right now. And if they do find them, I'll let you know what's happening there. But they crossed into Torchwood. The Pride crossed with Jamie on the Sunset Safari, and a Scarface actually crossed during the day. So I did promise I was going to take you to an area where we could have a look at how the elephants are changing the landscape. And they're one of the few sort of what you would call keystone species that are able to change the landscape. And another one of the keystone species in Africa for changing landscapes is the hippopotamus. And that's because they're quite often, not so much here, but in other areas, they'll keep river channels clear of water weeds and mud and silt by constantly walking up and down. And so another one of those important keystone species. There are very few species outside of human beings that are actually physically able to change the environment around them to suit themselves or have a major effect on the environment around them. And hippo and elephant and buffalo are three of those very important species that are able to do that. So we're going to just check the eastern edge of quarantine. Hopefully there will be some elephant this side. And I did forget to mention during the great race of 2015, in the process of defeating James, I popped a hamstring. Much to James's delight, I think that was the only thing he could take comfort in because of his loss, and it made it look a lot closer than it was. I should have won by quite a bit more if my hamstring hadn't decided to play up, but my hamstring is sufficiently recovered. Thank you, Donna. He was wondering about that, mentioning that. I did have to limp around a little bit, and for the first few days of my leave, it was a little bit sore, especially since we were walking quite long distances around Victoria Falls in Zimbabwe. Oh, let's see, I bet James is going to come back, and due to the fact that he lost, and Sharon thinks he's probably going to come back and go on and on about my days as an underwear model. Well, then my retort to James is, at least I had the opportunity to be an underwear model. Most of the answers coming through incorrect. It seems like we definitely gonna have to do a bit more tracking. The closest one that's come through so far is a scrub hare. A scrub hare leaves almost identical tracks to that, except it's a lot bigger. And I'll give you a little clue. It's smaller than a hare, and it is also a rodent. While you guys try to figure out what I'm talking about, let's go jump on the back with the gorgeous Jamie, who's with the most numerous antelope in Africa, south of the Sahara.
And we've actually appeared to have what looks like half the population of Impala on Juba wandering across the road. I've had to stop for a roadblock of Impala wandering through, and they just look so beautiful in this morning light. And it makes a nice change after chatting about the smelly hyenas. We're looking at one of the most fastidious antelope species within this particular area. They are constantly grooming and keeping clean. Unfortunately, they've all just gone across the road into some dense vegetation, but I wanted to show you how their coats shine in the morning light. Where are you going, guys? I'm going for a drink. Amazing to see how much the little baby impala have grown. Okay, let's try this lot. There's more that way, since our lot wants to disappear. Here we go, we've got one obliging lady. Gonna stick around, girl. You know, watch us from behind the bush. You've been left behind. I know that Brent mentioned as we were coming across here. Look at that. Oh, they're such graceful animals. I know that Brent mentioned that you're looking at the most numerous antelope species south of the Sahara. And safari, I'm so glad you've stayed with us for the sunrise safari. You wanted to know if we know the population of each of the animal species. We could probably give you rough totals. Censuses are done, but not necessarily published within the greater Kruger area every year. It's quite expensive to do a game count. Generally, for example, something like a wild dog is very carefully monitored. So we know pretty much exactly, down to the individual, exactly how many wild dog there are in here. It's around 194 in this particular area. With some of the other species, it's a little bit more difficult. So for example, the impala, how many would I say? I would guess there's about 200,000 of them in this particular park. Yeah, lots and lots and lots of them. And what's fascinating about them is that the way that they have evolved has remained unchanged for hundreds of thousands of years. They've hit upon the perfect successful species design. And their population almost, I would say, goes up by about a third every single year to help to maintain populations, even with the regularity that they fall victim to predation. So it's, being the most common antelope species, it's probably one of the most common prey species as well. And about, within the Kruger Park area itself, about 80% of a wild dog's diet consists of impala. Just in general populations, I mean, the lion population is pretty easy to estimate. within the Sabi Sands, which is a private conservancy that is... I just want to know what this hornbill's shouting at. Sorry, I've been watching it out of the corner of my eye. I'm gonna go back a little bit. It keeps screeching. And I can't quite work out what's upsetting it. I don't know if it's having a confrontation with another hornbill species, making a very unusual noise. What's happening here, guys? Are you begging for food? Are you two in competition? Looks like two males. Hard to tell because they're not sitting still. Or is it begging? Doesn't look like a juvenile to me. Are you guys fighting over berries or something? They seem to be plucking something off the tree. It looks as though the tree is fruiting. Maybe it's just a little bit of a squabble over the best and ripest fruits. They definitely seem to be munching on. I'm trying to work out what exactly this tree is. It's been so mauled by elephants that I can't quite tell. They are feeding. Hopping about. Look at how, this is actually fascinating to watch how agile they are in the way that they're gripping. Oops, dropped it. Quick, grab it. It's begging. It is, that bird's definitely begging. They're not in competition. Being fed by the individual on the left. That's interesting. Now this particular bird species, Sean, you've heard about or read about the relationship with dwarf mongoose, and you wanted to know whether that's true. And the answer is yes, and particularly with these yellow-billed hornbills, although it does occur with red-billed hornbills. And I'm going to explain it to you in a moment. I just want to get another view of them. They're going to disappear into the thick vegetation. So yes, Sean, the hornbills do have a really interesting relationship with, we're going to hit a roadblock here, with dwarf mongoose. It's something that scientists have done a significant amount of research into. And essentially, I'm just going to take this opportunity to pop a road here. Since this road has a couple of ditches that make life very difficult, so you'll just have to put up with me facing into the bushes in answer to the question until that other vehicle drives past. So Sean, the dwarf mongoose and the yellow-billed hornbill tend to go out foraging together. And what that means for them is that they can, the dwarf mongoose catch the various insect species, but they're quite messy eaters. Often some get away, some are injured, or the bits of the insects that they're after get left behind. So the hornbills can swoop down and grab it. For the dwarf mongoose, it means, which you can imagine, if you're a dwarf mongoose, your eyes are very close to the ground. And you never know when a predator might be lurking. There's a lot of different species out there that would love a dwarf mongoose as a snack. So having the hornbills around means that they've got an extra early warning system. But what's been so fascinating in the research that's done into this phenomenon is that certain hornbills, it's the same hornbills that associate with certain groups of dwarf mongoose, families of dwarf mongoose, and they've even recorded cases where the dwarf mongoose, if the hornbills are late, the dwarf mongoose show a reluctance to go out foraging. And if, on a cold morning, the dwarf mongoose decide to sleep in, the hornbills have actually been seen flying up to the entrance of their burrows and crawling down into the tunnels to wake them up, to get them to go out with them. And very often I've seen it with my own eyes that you see dwarf mongoose and yellow-billed hornbills foraging together. So they do have quite a tight association, and it's entirely mutually beneficial. It's also, I mean, to be fair, that's one example where you often see that relationship, but with all of the animal species, you'll find that they'll be quite happy to, that's why you had that bird feeding party with Brent, with them all moving together. You'll find that most animal species prefer to have safety in numbers, particularly the prey species. It seems as though there are some elephants left on Juma. Let's pop over to Brett so he can show you.
So we were going to show you what elephants do to the bush, and fortunately we can do that with an elephant in picture. So Steph on YouTube said, oh, I had a special request for Ellie's much earlier this morning. So here we go, Steph. Also, these Ellie's have just crossed in. We're quite close to our southern boundary that we've already driven down today. So these Ellie's have just crossed in, so perfect timing. And nice breeding herd. Let's get a little bit further and deeper into the breeding herd. You can see it, nice relaxed body language. So we're gonna make our way,
see if there's any little ones.
So remember, always pop your car into low range, nice even ribs when you're approaching Ellie's. Oh, there's a little one just through here. Monkey man, just quickly before we continue on with these Ellie's, Monkey Man, Molly, Mary and Lynn got that little track question correct. It is a squirrel. I'm going to sneak forward a little bit. See, and also always remember when you start the car, especially when you're in close proximity, there we go, so it's going to pop out for us, two elephants. Let the car run for a few seconds so they get used to the noise before you start moving. It's another way to make sure you don't upset the animals. And there we go, there's a little fork-tailed dronga taking advantage of any insects disturbed by the Ellie's. So now I'm going to move a little bit forward. You look like you're up to mischief. Very much mischievous face there. And oh, elephant argument behind us somewhere. It sounded like someone being chastised. Oh, there we go. She's tail up, trumpeting. I just got a glimpse of her through the bush. I wonder what gave her a fright. It could be that she's having an argument with another elephant. She could have seen a predator and liked you though. Let's see why she's so upset. Could be one of those teenage boys causing havoc. And there she comes. She is very upset. I'm going to stop the car. This is a bit of misplaced aggression coming at us. It's okay. Stop it. It's okay. So something upset her that wasn't us. It was quite far away from us, but she's come charging. Nonsense. Enough nonsense now. There we go. So again, very important in reading elephant behavior. If we had to drive or move and make a lot of noise now, look at that. She's just showing us how strong she is. She would probably chase us, but if we keep still, and not move, you can see she's moving away. That was a very, very, very good example of displacement anger being caused by something else. That's why when there are big must bulls and that around, this behavior can be quite common. You have to be more careful with the breeding herd. And so the rest of the herd behind her are still completely ignoring her temper tantrums. She's a youngish female. So a prime candidate for harassment by big bulls. Look at that, she just flattened, Andrew, flattened that tree. And you can see now her tail's still slightly erect and she is still a little bit uncomfortable. You see her tail's going down now, she's relaxing. So that was very important for those of you who drive around in Kruger. And now you can see her tail's flapping if we come out a bit nicely. She's changed, she's not upset anymore. That little bit of behavior we saw there was, we just happened to be around when she was angry. She could have done that to another elephant. And the way she pushed that tree, she made sure there were two bushes and another tree in between us. So she felt safe because there was stuff between us and her, but she still wanted to remind us how strong and powerful she can be. So we've got a comment from a new sailor who's, this is their first drive, and says, "Are you crazy, Brent?" Well, yes, I saw that, Andrew. I see how you try to get it in without me spotting. I am slightly crazy, but not when it comes to animals. I have a huge respect for these animals. And fortunately, I've grown up in areas with them. And the first time, one of my first memories is actually walking up to elephants. And knowing what to do and how to read their behavior is how you stay safe out here. So if we try to move away fast, she would have got more worked up, the noise of the engine revving and that, and that would have caused us to chase, caused her to chase us. She's now completely calm and feeding. So that's good. I'm gonna move forward slightly so you can see her, and you can see how her body language has completely changed. And that is a really important thing, guys. If you are driving yourself around in an area where there's elephants, watch their tails. When the tails are erect, they are upset. So you might not see some of the other signs, but it's a very nice, big, visible sign. There she is. Doesn't look like. And if we look at her now, it's hard to believe she was charging at us and knocking down trees. Not even 30, or not even 2 minutes ago. And let's go have a look what actually could have caused that behavior. It happened over there. Let's go see. There might be one of those big bulls, or maybe some of those teenage bulls that can get a little bit rough and tumble. And that's quite often when the young eddies get to the age of sort of between 12 and 15, especially the boys, that the females will push them out of the breeding herd because of that rambunctious behavior. Annie is saying to Sailor, the new viewer, if you want to see some really crazy elephant stuff, there's a video of myself with elephants chasing wild dogs. So if you enjoyed that little elephant insert we just had, maybe you should go have a look at those ellies chasing the wild dogs with me a couple of months ago. So I can't see any big bulls. A little boy here. Two little boys. So there you go. There's one little boy, and maybe she just got a fright. It's very difficult. I can't see anything that could have caused that. Maybe she could have possibly even seen a snake. Who knows? And there we go. And there's a little boy right in the thick of the buffalo thorn, munching away. They are incredible animals. Austin, who's 13 and still with us, wonders if we have specific names for certain elephants or certain herds of elephants. Austin, we see a lot of elephants. The problem with elephants is they move around so much that they can be here for quite a while and then we won't see them for 2 or 3 months. So it makes it a little bit difficult for us to keep constant IDs on them. But there are distinguishing features, like we can see this little boy here is missing his left tusk. They probably broke it either playing or using it to break down trees or whatnot. So he's only got one tusk, so that, for example, would be quite a nice distinguishing feature for him. Also, you look for tears in the ears and very, very rarely, very distinct skin patterns. So there was one young little elephant bull, and he must be about 1.5 to 2 years now, that we nicknamed Mr. Wrinkly Bottom, and he had a very distinct sort of a skin pattern, but that is unusual, and unless you're following the same elephants on a daily basis, it does become a little bit difficult to discern them, and they do move in and out, and we get different herds constantly. Young bull elephants that have been pushed out of the breeding herds form bachelor groups. They do, Michael, and also quite often, especially when they've just been pushed out and they're still a little bit nervous, they will trail the breeding herd. So quite often when you find a couple of young bulls that sort of seems to be by themselves on the edge, if you carry on a little bit further, you'll find a group of females and youngsters. Let's go have a quick look here. So as impressive as it was, she chose a very good tree to flatten. If we have a look on the inside, the termites have eaten it. So it was a bit easier to push down than it would have been if it was completely healthy, but still I don't think I would have been able to do that with my forehead. Maybe Andrew, he might be able to. Okay, the rest of it is going to move out into the road over there. So let's go and join them. Stand by here and wait for these ellies to move out in front of us. Jamie's got a very interesting bird to show you.
One of the most striking bird species, or at least shrike species. Oh dear. Birds, man. Hold on, I can still see it. Live wildlife filming. You just never know when that bird's gonna disappear off. Here we go. Luckily it hasn't gone too far away, so we can still have a look at it with its long tail. This is a long-tailed shrike, or that's the old name at least. It's now called a magpie shrike. And it really is a very attractive looking bird. Interestingly enough, one of the few species where both the male and the female have long, long tails, which is something I've always questioned as to why. Because obviously with long tails, that's usually a male's approach to breeding plumage to impress the ladies. I'm not sure what it is, and usually it's a disadvantage because those heavy tail feathers actually slow the bird down and make it harder to fly. So why it is that both male and female magpie shrikes have long tails, nobody's ever been able to properly answer my question. But with this awesome camera, we can actually have a look at the feathers around its face and around its beak. Now, what birds have similar to the whiskers of cats. Yeah, have a look there. Thank you, Tibbs. You can see all around the fluffiness. Now, those are known as rictal bristles. And it's similar to the effect of whiskers. Bye-bye. Off he goes. This time, gone for good. But yes, the rictal bristles around the face have sensory nerves attached to them as a way of helping the bird both navigate and also know exactly when to close their beak around a prey species, so something like an insect. My goodness. Well, anyway, I just wanted to show you that quickly. Brent is still with his elephants, so let's pop back over there.
Sally's slowly moving, and she's just turned her bottom to us. So, sneak forward a skosh. There we can. There we go. Sneak between the trees. There's a little guy. Only about 2 years old. You can see the little tusks protruding. So they're born with milk tusks that they lose at about a year old, and then their main set of tusks start coming through. And before we were rudely interrupted by that slightly upset female, there was a question, I can't remember exactly what it was from, about do Asian elephants have bigger tusks than African? As far as I know, not. The largest ever recorded tusk is from an African elephant, and it was from Tanzania, said to have been shot on the slopes of Mount Kilimanjaro by a local slave trader by the name of Tipo Tip, and those weighed around 200 and Diana, there we go. Diana wanted to know about elephant tusks. And as far as I know, these are the largest tusks ever recorded out of all elephant species. And it, as I said, shot by Tipo Tip on the slopes of Mount Kilimanjaro. And they weighed around 240 pounds apiece. So incredible that. And they've had quite an interesting life since then, and they've moved around a bit. So they were taken by Tipo Tip to the Sultan of Zanzibar. So they were taken and given to the Sultan of Zanzibar. The Sultan of Zanzibar then gifted them to the British consulate on Zanzibar, where they hung on his veranda for many years before eventually being then donated to the British Museum of Natural History. And if you are ever in London, you can actually go visit those tusks. And they are incredible, longer than I am tall, much longer than I am tall. And obviously they weigh quite a bit more than me as well. It said it took 3 slaves to carry each tusk. So there we go. Tipo Tip, Sultan of Zanzibar, British consulate. Lots of fantastic little stories from the history of Africa. Just trying to see where the best view is. Liz would like to know, are there ever casualties with the young bulls when they're first pushed out? And Liz, not really, very seldom. Unless you're an elephant who lives in northern Botswana, specifically around the Pondo-Lenyanti-Sabuti area, where you have lions that have specialized in hunting those young bulls as they first get pushed out. But in most places, not normally. And look what we have here. Look who's coming to join us at the elephants. It looks like Jamie. Coming down the road, Jamie and Tibbs. Oh, now they're trying to sneak, but we've spotted them. You know, they can't hide from us. If I can spot a leopard track, I surely can spot my girlfriend coming down the road, one would hope.
Hello?
Hello. Is it still? And you can see Jamie has forgotten to turn her lights off because they're shining brightly in the daylight.
There we go. Quite embarrassing.
There we go.
That's very unfortunate. Good thing I came around.
Yes, you killed the battery. And there you can see Teb's trying to concentrate intently, like most cameramen. They tend to try avoid being on camera and try hide behind their cameras as much as possible. There you go. Staring down the viewfinder. We're going to carry on and go back into where the Ellies are. Maybe you might get a bit of view. There's some on the other side of the road as well.
Of course, we both were in the last moment today. She didn't enjoy.
There we go. A randomer bumping into. And here we go. Here come the Ellies. So, just to finish off with Lissa's question about the casualty with young bulls, so it's very unusual most of the time. Once they get beyond that sort of 10-year-old, it's very seldom that they become casualties. And as we know, elephants are very long-lived. They can live to about 65 years. And they're just slowly feeding through the bush here. And what you quite often find is that when elephants are not on a mission, so heading to a specific area, they will spread out, and the herd can be spread out over quite a vast distance, a couple of hundred meters, while they feed. It's been a beautiful morning out here in the bush, even though there hasn't been that much cat activity. Well, there has, but the tracks have unfortunately led away from us. But that's one of the things about being in the bush. They could quite easily come back during the day or tomorrow, and keeps us excited. We love being able to track the big cats, and I'm just happy there's lots of Ellies back. So it's been wonderful. Don't forget to join us on the Sunset Safari. Also, a big happy birthday to our Commander-in-Chief, Mr. Graham Wallington. I'm not going to say how old he's turning. Might be a bit embarrassing. But a happy, happy birthday to Graham. I hope Em and the kids have a great day with you guys. So I think we're going to go see Jamie for the last little bit of drive. So bye, and we'll see you on the Sunset Safari.
And surprise, surprise, Tebs and myself have also encountered a couple of the stragglers of the elephant herd that Brent is being with. I didn't realize that he was coming down this road, otherwise I would have chosen a different route, but I guess I could say I just couldn't go another 5 minutes without saying hello to him. But a really wonderful morning, and I just want to join Brent as well in wishing Graham a huge happy birthday from all of the Wild Earth staff. Of course, you guys all know that without Graham, none of this would be possible. So a big happy birthday, Graham. I hope you're having a wonderful day out and about celebrating. We're all sending you lots and lots of love. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it has been a beautiful and somewhat peaceful morning after the incredible excitement of yesterday. Really stunning sky. It's a beautiful day that's going to come through ahead. And I've absolutely enjoyed being out with all of you. So thank you all. It's been a pleasure and a privilege to have you on the back of our vehicle. And thank you for your questions and your comments. It has been great. A big thank you to Tebs for his fantastic camera work and his cameo appearance, of course, as well as to the lovely ladies in FC. So join Brent and I think myself. No, sorry, Scott and myself will be on this afternoon. So join us for the Sunset Safari. Cheers for now.